In all my experience of 12 weeks now owning an adopted dog, I feel like such the voice of wisdom.
Yes, you are.
One of the most interesting things I've learned is the difference between adopting a rescue who has a past and has triggers and has had bad stuff in their life versus people who adopt a puppy who come all clean and happy and life is great.
That's right, and you've done one and I've done the other.
Exactly,
so it's
different.
It is interesting.
Mm-hmm. And in both cases, we needed a trainer.
That's true.
And we needed the trainer. The dogs were just fine.
I totally feel that way, that Rocky trained me.
Totally. And so Patti Dennis, our guest, trained me and has helped Libby do the work with me immensely. The two of them working on me has actually been the greatest success.
That's wonderful.
Patti, thank you so much for joining
us. Thank you for having me.
Yeah, we're very excited, and I know that your specialty is rescue animals.
Rescue animals. I have several subsets, but I do a lot of work with rescues, and I think it's important to break down the different categories of dogs in general. You have your puppies, as you say, your clean bill that come from breeders, hopefully good breeders, because that does make a difference. So that's one type of dog, and usually they're acquired at 8, 9 weeks, something like that. So they are fresh and usually don't come with too many issues. And then you have perhaps a rescue dog that has either been found on the street wandering or an owner turn in for some reason. Anything is like we're moving and we don't want to bother with it or anything like that. So it loses its home due to something like that. Then you have the puppy mills, which are generally the dogs, usually puppies that are sold in pet stores. And hopefully the education has become much more widespread in that way, because they come from puppy mills that they have no regard at all for the health of the breeding stock or the puppies that are produced. And many of the puppies are very, very ill and have genetic issues. They've been inbred and so on and so forth. Then you have the actual rescue organizations that will go into the places where the dogs have been brought to, and they'll pull them out into their own rescue. And they rely extremely highly on foster care so that the dogs can go and live right away, hopefully, in a home setting and get them ready to go to their new home. So those are like some of the different categories, and they each come with their challenges. A rescue dog found on the street, often you'll have absolutely zero history on them, not know anything about what's, you know, their life has been like or whatever you may guess as far as their behavior, but it's not, sometimes it can be confusing. Then you have dogs that have been like Libby, that is, I consider, a miracle dog, that had such a trauma, and she has just bounced back with your love and care and dedication, unbelievable dedication, to become what everybody would want as a dog. I mean, there's nothing, she's not lacking in any way.
No,
so
she's
that's the
amazing
misconception, that just because somebody gets a rescue dog, that, well, there's something going to be wrong with them. It's true. Sometimes they do have issues. She had some fear issues of cars, rightly so. And other dogs may have fears of this or that. But with patience from the people that adopt them and some knowledge, hopefully a lot of knowledge from whatever rescue they're adopting from, all the issues that come along with the dog can be taken care of, and the dog can go on to have a wonderful life. So those are really important points to make out. And as far as what I see from a day-to-day business standpoint, when I go in to do consultations like I did with you, with her, and many of them are much more problematic than she was. People didn't do their homework. I mean, they didn't consider, I like this dog, I like the looks of this dog, let's get this dog. They didn't consider whether or not the breeds, because they very likely might be a mixed breed, would fit their household? Is the personality good for their household? Not all dogs are good around children. Not all dogs are good around other dogs. Not all dogs are good with cats. Mm-hmm. And people need to think more carefully about those things and try to spend as much time as they can with the dog before they bring it home. You know, see it in its setting, and just like you're doing right here, you know, the good reputable rescues will have a place where you can take the dog and play with it and kind of bond with it a little bit, although it's not the same as a home. It's something.
But it was definitely something. Even sitting with her on the lawn for the 20 minutes with the handler and watching her and getting a sense of her energy, even though she was in such a highly traumatic state at the time. But I think the key was, he said to me, you have 30 days. If it doesn't work out, no questions asked. We want everybody to be happy. We need you to be happy. We need the dog to be happy. And that was really what helped me say, okay, I can try this. I have faith in this dog. I have a good feeling about this dog, but you don't know for sure.
No, you don't.
And even when you came, it was so good to have the 2-hour private with you and then be able to move into the group class and give her that experience.
Round her out. With a little world traveling, too.
she's
traveled more than I have.
She has traveled more than a lot of people have.
And that's another good point you made. A good, reputable rescue, as opposed to a shelter like the Orange County Shelter or something like that, they insist on getting their dogs back. They're always chipped before they leave, and mm-hmm. spayed and neutered. And they insist on getting them back if for some reason it doesn't go well. And that's a sign of a good rescue as opposed to, I don't want them back. You know, it's your problem now.
Mm-hmm. So in terms of the training, though, what do you see, say, your top 3 training items that people could actually use today on their dog at home, even the ones I'm using on Libby every single day that you've taught me?
Okay, it's much like a small child. They thrive on structure, especially if they're coming from a situation where they had no structure, they had no confidence in themselves or their world. So structure is very important, and that's not a mean thing. That's just letting them understand what's going to be in your household and helping them understand that. A huge issue with a lot of rescues that I deal with highly is separation anxiety. Mm. She might have had just a touch mm-hmm. of it, but very little. I mean, we're talking dogs that will chew doorways that they're so traumatized.
Oh, wow. No, now she'll whine for a few minutes by the door, but if there's another human, they can distract her instantly. Mm. You know, if you've got a treat in your hand, she's your best friend.
But then, and then if they leave, she's okay then.
And if they leave, she's going to do the same thing. She'll whine for a minute or two, and then she goes off and goes to sleep.
And that's perfect.
Yeah.
I mean, that's perfect. So that would be what everybody would want to get to. Sometimes it's more difficult for the dog. It's very individual. So structure, set down the rules from day one. We love them. We feel bad for their previous life or trauma or whatever, but unfortunately just giving love and hugs and kisses is not going to fix them. Mm-hmm. Not that you don't give them affection, of course you do, but they need to understand what their world is going to be now and be able to depend on that. And that's mm-hmm. how they learn to trust us. Mm-hmm. And because they can trust us, they learn to be a lot more confident, and that just makes them a better dog.
Right.
That's what I've seen most, is she has confidence that I'm there. So when we're out walking, now if she sees something that would historically have triggered her, she looks at me.
Yeah.
And if I say, you're okay, we keep walking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If I'm not paying attention, if I'm not watching her and there's something that she knows is not good out there, I'm going to hear about it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I'm mm-hmm. grateful. I think it's been a huge step.
Yes, and it's very important that people don't understand that their dog... and that could be just puppies too, just regular, any old dog. They need to trust us humans that we are going to be protecting them, not in the sense of holding them against the world, but in the sense that we won't let things bad happen to them. Mm-hmm. And that's how you build a confident dog, and a confident dog is a dog that's happy.
Yeah.
So.
And in the world, a confident, well-behaved dog is welcome everywhere.
Absolutely.
Because it's those outbreaks that I find people, that's what turns people off, and that's what shuts down so much opportunity for them to be a bigger part of your life.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, that's right.
Did you have a trainer for Rocky?
We had a trainer who came in and gave us some ground rules, and it was awesome. Like, he was fantastic. We felt like he really, like, was communicating on, like, a mental level with him somehow. I really admire you guys who are able to, like, really connect and understand dogs. So I thought that it was a fantastic experience for us. And then after that, then we just took his sheet and we checked off our boxes and it worked out great.
Well, that went really well. Mm-hmm. I've been doing this for almost 30 years now, so and I'm still learning every single day. Every new dog, I learn something new because they're all different and they're not cookie cutter. Just like in class, every single person and their dog, I handle them differently. And, you know, that's obviously an acquired talent that takes time. You can go to school for it and get a PhD, but it really doesn't show, you know, when you get out there in the real world.
There's nothing like experience.
Yeah, exactly.
I remember my first walk around the community with Patti, and when she would bark, she had different barks. Mm-hmm. And she could tell me, this is a fear bark, this is a protective bark, this isn't like... Oh, okay.
Isn't that interesting how then you start getting to understand? Because I'd never really been close to a pet before. And so the day that I realized that, like, this little whine meant I want food, but this little whine meant I want to go outside. And, like, the day that I understood that, I was like, oh, I can speak dog!
That was amazing.
I have to say probably my most embarrassing moment, though, was when my daughter's 8-year-old friend came over and said, your dog needs to go to the bathroom. I'm like, wait, what? She's standing there right by the door barking. Like, and she had dogs, so she knew exactly what was going on. And I'm like, oh, thanks, London. You know? Yes. So we're all learning.
Communication is definitely a two-way road. And sometimes there's rocky starts, you know. Mm-hmm. The dog could be trying to tell you something and it doesn't make sense to us or whatever. And so sometimes it takes some, continued working on it. Right. Oh, that's it, you know.
Yeah, that's right.
Patti, I would love people to be able to find out more from you. How can they find you?
Well, I have a website, vpdogtraining.com.
And we'll put that on the screen.
Yeah.
And
I'm on Facebook, too. Actually, I enjoy my Facebook page. It's very small, it's basically just my people. You know, I don't sell anything, never want to sell anything. All I do is try to post articles dealing with various issues that people run into day in and day out to help them with their dog at home, no charge, of course, or anything for that. So that's VP Dog Training is easy to find on Facebook. Those are the two main things.
Great. So. Thank you so much for sharing with us.
Thank you. I really appreciate you coming in.
And Libby appreciates all you have added to the quality of her life.
She's awesome.
So thank you. And we'll be right back.
She's so wild.